Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Rabbi shrahli sadri wa yassirli amri wahlul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli. Rabbi zidni ilma. In Surah Nisa, ayah number 75, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "And what is the matter with you that you fight not in the cause of Allah and for the oppressed among men and women and children who say, 'Our Lord, take us out of this city of oppressive people and appoint for us from yourself a protector and appoint for us from yourself a helper.'" It is an unfortunate reality of our times that our Muslim brethren are being oppressed and brutally killed. In light of the current events, today this will be the topic of our discussion. But before that, let's find out what is meant by zulm or injustice. The word al-zulm, oppression, is opposite to the word al-adl, justice, and is derived linguistically from the word zalama, which means injustice, darkness, aggression, doing the inappropriate. It is an Arabic word used interchangeably for cruelty or unjust acts of exploitation, oppression, and wrongdoing, whereby a person either deprives others of their rights or does not fulfill his obligations towards them. Zulm can be categorized into three kinds. Zulm against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is the first category, and it includes not fulfilling the haqq of Allah or associating partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, basically doing shirk. The second category of zulm is against mankind, when the honor, property, life and wealth of fellow humans is not respected or looked after. The third kind is when a person gets morally corrupt and indulges in a variety of sins, crimes or debaucheries. Moving on, let's see what Quran has to say about zulm. We find out in Surah Ali Imran, ayah number 86, that Allah does not guide the wrongdoing people. In Surah Hud, ayah number 18, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "The curse of Allah is upon the wrongdoers." In ayah 57, Surah Ali Imran, very categorically it is said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not like the wrongdoers. In Surah Ashura, ayah number 45, it is also said, unquestionably, the wrongdoers are in an enduring punishment. Allah's Apostle sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Help your brother, whether he is an oppressor or he is an oppressed one." People asked, "Oh Allah's Apostle, it is all right to help him if he is oppressed, but how should we help him if he is an oppressor?" Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "By preventing him from oppressing others." This hadith is mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume 3, book 43, hadith number 624. Therefore, in light of the above hadith, we see that we should not be silent spectators to oppression. We should take appropriate measures to stop the injustice. Now, this does not mean to get emotional and jump in the conflict and become a target yourself. No, but be practical and realistically try to diffuse or solve the conflict. Being astute and prudent demands to seek help, as there is strength in numbers. If this is not possible, then condemn the oppression with your entire being. There are many ways to absolve injustice, and inshallah we'll talk about these ways today. The entire Muslim Ummah seems to be plagued by some critical issue or the other. May it be Afghanistan, Iraq, Palestine, Syria, Bosnia, Chechnya, Kashmir, Burma, Somalia or Yemen. Wherever we see, the media is plastered with the carnage, bloodbath and dead bodies of Muslims. The atrocities committed against them are hair-raising and blood-curdling. We have seen chemical bombs being thrown on Aleppo and Idlib. Bombardments being done on funeral processions in Palestine, and no one seems to care. Iraqis being massacred with innovative methods, and in Burma, the slaughter got even more gruesome and horrific. Daily Muslims are butchered, burnt alive, their children and their women are not spared. They are buried alive, their bodies mutilated. You name the crime against humanity, and it is done there on a much larger scale. Now let's see how we can contribute and help the Muslims suffering all around the globe, especially in Burma. Firstly, this issue should be presented in the United Nations and appeals should be made on a global level. The world should not be allowed to turn a blind eye to the plight of the Muslims. The Pakistani media should make this issue their core concern and play their part as well. Mind you, here I don't mean at all that plaster and paint the internet with pictures of the massacre and make them go viral. No, I would not want my pictures to go viral if I was in their state. We need to learn to respect the deceased. The minimum we can do is respect them in their last moments and give them some respite. Rather than forwarding their pictures, we can express our discontent, pray for them, and we can express our sorrow by pinning our thoughts and having the articles printed in the newspaper. Peaceful protests can be carried out to show our support and agitation. On a global level, all the 50 Muslim countries should unite and do something about the oppression in Burma. For once, we should put our differences away on a national and international level and become one body, like mentioned in the Quran and Sunnah. Appeals can be made to the Bangladeshi government to accommodate the refugees. Financial assistance can be given. This issue can even be brought up in the OIC meetings. I mean, why not? Developed countries like Saudi Arabia should step in and take active control. Countries like Turkey have already pledged to provide financial assistance, and we too can do the same. Again, every step counts, and we can start collecting funds for them. The funds can even be given to a reputable international relief organization. Your protests can be lodged with the Burmese embassy as well. Come to think of it, the entire earth is scattered with Muslim countries. If all of them try to take in a few refugees, then there will be no issue left, inshallah. Bilateral relations can be established between Burmese neighboring countries to provide aid or shelter. The last thing we want is history to repeat itself. American troops to land on the Muslim populated areas and take control. Pakistan, Thailand, Malaysia can also hold talks with the Burmese government to put an end to the genocide. Otherwise, all Burmese would be evicted from their countries and a boycott would be declared against them. This situation would pose a threat to the Burmese economy. Prospect of 18 lakh plus people back might make them take heed and put an end to the innocent killings. Efforts should be made to convince other nations to join in the protests and also to stop giving Burma military aid. Muslim heads of states should go on official trips and have talks to convince people to join in on humanitarian grounds, if nothing else. On our own level, we should regularly make dua for the Burmese Muslims, make sincere supplications to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to ease their suffering and grant them peace. Sadaqah is supposed to ward off calamities. We should give sadaqah in their name. Recite kunut nazla during salah. The most important being, if we truly wish injustice to end in the world and Muslims to be free of oppression and subjugation, then we need to hold on to the Quran and Sunnah. Follow the commands present in the Quran and be humble and obedient slaves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inshallah, the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will surely come. Let's pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts the martyrdom and raises the ranks of the martyrs of Burma, grant patience and fortitude to their relatives, and from His infinite mercy, help them, grant them respite and freedom from this tyranny. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unite us all Muslims, and may we always stand as a wall in face of adversity if anyone dares threaten the Muslim Ummah. Ameen. I will end today's talk with the same words which our Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said on the day of the Battle of Ahzab. O Allah, the revealer of the Holy Book, the quick taker of accounts, defeat the clans and shake them. Inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu.